Oh, hey, I didn't see you there. You know, one of my favorite things to do is to learn about urban legends. As a kid, I would often go online and find true ghost stories to freak myself out. Even if I knew they were made up, I would often ask myself, what if it's true? What if you didn't continue that chain letter? What if it wasn't your dog who licked your hand in the middle of the night? And what if you said a certain name a certain number of times in the mirror? Nothing would happen, sure, but are you prepared for the consequences in case of the slim chance that you're wrong? Helen Lyle wasn't. And that's why today we're taking a look at the 1992 film that scared audiences nationwide and spread rumors across schools warning kids not to say his name in the mirror 5 times. That's right, today we're taking a look at Candyman and its journey to its final picture. There are many urban legends that don't have a clear origin, which is part of the reason why they can be so creepy. It's a simple story passed down from generation to generation, possibly blurring the lines between fact and fiction. However, Candyman can be led back to a 1985 short story written by young horror author Clive Barker. It was released in his book titled In the Flesh, which was later renamed to Volume 5 of the Books of Blood. This is a series of short stories written by Barker, with the first one being The Forbidden. If you don't know who Clive Barker is, he's the man responsible for the 1987 film Hellraiser, a sick and disturbing movie that introduced us to horror icon Pinhead, who wasn't focused on until the sequels, but anyways, let's go ahead and take a look at how this film adaptation even came to be. British director Bernard Rose was filming Chicago Girl and The Showgirl in LA, while Clive Barker was directing his second feature film, Nightbreed. Because they were both shooting at Pinewood Studios, they met up for lunch. At this point, Bernard Rose wasn't familiar with any of the work of Clive Barker. Months after their lunch, Rose came across his Books of Blood series. After reading it, one of the stories stood out to him for its commentary on social class in the slums of Liverpool. Rose called Barker asking for permission to pitch The Forbidden as a feature film. Barker enjoyed Rose's first film, Paper House, so he felt he would leave the film adaptation in good hands. After receiving Barker's blessing, Rose went on to have a meeting with producer Steve Golan at Propaganda Films. The studio loved his pitch and asked Rose who would write the script. At this point in his life, Rose was struggling financially, so his immediate answer was that he would write the screenplay himself in order to get a bigger paycheck. They agreed on a deal and Rose flew back to the UK. The funny thing about this story is that Rose had never written anything before. Nervous the studio would find out, Rose banged out a script in 4 weeks. Back in Hollywood, an old friend Rose had a falling out with questioned producer Steve Golan why Rose was hired to write the script adaptation if he had never written a screenplay in his life. So, Golan called Rose in an attempt to break their initial deal. The studio still wanted him to direct, but they wanted to hire someone else to write the script. Rose told his agent that he was done writing it, so the agent asked him to quickly ship it over to LA. Because Rose typed it out with a typewriter, he had the properly type it out and format before FedExing the script over to Hollywood. According to Bernard Rose, this process took at least 10 days. When his agent received the script, he called Steve Golan and told him it was okay to break the deal, but wanted him to sign a claim that he had no lien on the film. Golan quickly assumed the agent wanted this claim because the script was good and could be sold to other production companies. Golan told Rose's agent to send it over because he owned the screenplay, signifying their original deal was still on. The agent told Golan that they couldn't receive the script unless they sent the check, and so the studio did. 24 hours after receiving the screenplay, Golan called Rose and told him to get on a plane to LA because they were making the movie. Steve Golan called up producer Ellen Poole, who was producing an R-rated anthology film called Inside Out, and told him about the up-and-coming English director. Poole met with Rose, read Candyman, and immediately signed on to the project. With the project greenlit, it was time to cast the film. Early on in pre-production, Bernard Rose was going to do this film with his wife at the time, Alexandra Pitt. Pig, who would play the part of Helen. Virginia Madsen was set to play Bernadette, which would later be played by Kasi Lemmons. Then Alexandra got pregnant and said if anyone would take her spot, it should be Virginia Madsen. Rose had known Madsen through his fellow director friend Danny Huston, who was married to Madsen at the time. Previous to this film, Madsen was mostly known for her role in David Lynch's Dune. And fun fact, Virginia Madsen's brother is Michael Madsen, who later played Mr. Blonde in Reservoir Dogs and other characters in the Tarantino multiverse. Even though Rose was pretty set on Virginia Madsen playing Helen, he still wanted to look at other candidates just in case. They picked out a handful of unknown actors that could play Helen in case Madsen wasn't able to do the film for any reason. One of those actors they liked best was Sandra Bullock, who wouldn't find her breakthrough role until 1994 with the action thriller Speed. Virginia Madsen had to get allergy tested prior to shooting because she was allergic to bee stings, and Bernard Rose didn't believe her, so she went to get tested at UCLA with different types of venom, and it turned out she was in fact hyperallergic to bee stings. During production, they had to have an ambulance and paramedics behind the camera in case one of those hundreds of bees stung her. Thankfully, the bees that were on her were all babies who couldn't fly, so were more calmer and less likely to sting. In regards to the look of the character, Rose didn't see Madsen as Helen, so he asked her for a few things to help her grow into that character. First thing he asked for was for her to cut her hair short, which was something Madsen had already been wanting to do for a while. The second thing was to gain a little weight so her character looked rounder and more real. Madsen was a bit hesitant in regards to gaining weight, so what Bernard Rose did was he would go knock on her dressing room door during lunch and offer her her favorite food, a slice of pizza. Then with each passing day, he would bring more slices, so she just went with it because who can honestly reject pizza? Because it was important that Helen felt real, Rose asked hair and makeup to do the minimal amount of work on Madsen, which likely meant just powdering her face to avoid any shine. The only time she would wear makeup was when Helen was entranced by Candyman, and even then they would only add mascara, a little bit of lip stain, and use soft lighting to enhance Madsen's looks. With Helen cast, it was time to find the first major horror icon of the 90s, Candyman himself. Tony Todd's agent reached out to him and told him about a role where he would play a character called Candyman. Todd immediately hung up, thinking it was some sort of prank or a Sammy Davis Jr. biopic. The agent called back and explained it was a horror film based on a Clive Barker short story. According to Todd, there was also talk of bringing in someone with an Eddie Murphy type vibe, which was a major turnoff for him. Thankfully, Bernard Rose stepped in and clarified the film would be serious and have more depth to it. As far as it seems, Tony Todd was the first choice for Candyman. Prior to Candyman, Todd had roles in Platoon, Star Trek The Next Generation, and The Night of the Living Dead remake. According to Rose, one of the only other people in the running was Dorian Harewood, who's mostly known for his role in Full Metal Jacket. In an interview with Todd, he talks about how Bernard Rose had to fight to get certain aspects of the film made. The NAACP was afraid that Rose would put a black man in a bad light.
Bernard Rose is one of the most intelligent directors I've ever worked with. I mean, I'm not going to make any excuses for his lack or depth of racial comparisons, but I know the man's heart, and I know he fought. Not only did he have to fight with the NAACP, who was afraid of a horror film that was going to depict an African-American man in a bad light, but it is a horror film, and I think we won that battle over the test of time.
Rose and Todd agree that they wanted the film interpretation of Candyman to be similar to Lon Chaney in Phantom of the Opera, where there was a gothic elegance to his monstrosity. On top of that, there are also many elements taken from The Mummy starring Boris Karloff, in which the ancient Egyptian prince searches for his lost love. Todd's casting would end up being a major landmark for the horror genre, since it depicted one of the first mainstream black supernatural killers. Todd said that whether it was done accidentally or purposely, Bernard Rose created a framework around America's history with racial politics to Candyman. Another major milestone was the relationship between Candyman and Helen. Bernard Rose gave Virginia Madsen and Tony Todd the freedom to create their own backstories, and Todd came up with the idea that Candyman was brutally lynched after having an affair with a white woman he was painting a portrait of. In the final film, there are romantic elements between Helen and Candyman. According to Tony Todd, studios were nervous to show Helen and Candyman romantically spinning, but like Todd says, they were fine with showing a dead dead black man covered in bees. To put this in perspective, when this film was being made, interracial marriage had barely been legal in the US for 25 years. To prepare for their scenes, both Virginia Madsen and Tony Todd took waltzing and fencing classes to create that greater sense of chemistry. Another way that Tony Todd prepared for the role was by working with bee wrangler Norman Gary. No joke, during production, the bees had their own trailer where they would all buzz around. Gary asked Todd to enter the room and get used to the flying insects. He even asked Todd to give them all individual names. While Todd found this to be excessive, he later realized it was to help calm any fear of working with hundreds of bees on your body. According to Madsen, working with bees wasn't as bad as it sounds. She said that it doesn't feel like bugs are crawling on you, but is more comparable to the sensation of a Q-tip running up and down your arms. While on set, crew members had to tape down their pant leg to make sure bees didn't go up their butt, Ant-Man style. They also had a representative from the ASPCA come to set and make sure the bees weren't being harmed, which made some people unhappy since bees would inadvertently get smacked or stepped on.
What he does is he puts little tiny dots of pheromones like wherever the bees are to go. Then he stands up above you with basically a jar full of bees and kind of goes like this, and they go and they like fall on you. And that's the only moment where you go, bees, bees. Then they start to spread out and they start to move around, and that part's okay.
The film has its share of grotesque special effects, so Bob Keane was offered the job of one of the effects artists while working on Hellraiser 3. Gary J. Tunnicliffe, Mark Cullier, and Dave Keane were also hired for the special effects work. The major prop they needed to make prior to filming was Candyman's hook. They had a blacksmith create this prop, however, when Tunnicliffe and Bob Keane went to go pick it up, the blacksmith asked what the prop was for. After saying it was for a Clive Barker adaptation called Candyman, the man took the hook, threw it in his drawer, and told the effects artists they were Satan's spawn. Tunnicliffe ended up making the hook by hand and using that frustration with the blacksmith to help hammer it together. To create the feces on the wall, the artists used different types of biscuits like digestive, chocolate, and ginger to create the texture. Then they went around painting the set, so there's your recipe in case you want a shitty wall for your film. That's enough pre-production talk. Let's go ahead and pop this sucker in to get a better understanding of what went on behind the scenes and figure out the structure behind this haunting story. The film starts off with some aerial shots of Chicago. These shots were accomplished by riding up in a helicopter with a new rig they created that could point the camera directly down to the streets of the city. This was part of the week-long Chicago shoot the filmmakers had to get any important exteriors they wanted. According to Bernard Rose, this opening shot was inspired by the opening line of The Forbidden, which reads, "Like a flawless tragedy, the elegance of which structure is lost upon those suffering in it. The perfect geometry of the Spectre Street estate was only visible from the air." This intro also introduces us to the amazing score by Philip Glass. Prior to this project, he had mostly worked on documentaries but was focused on writing operas and music theater works. At one point in his musical career, Glass even claimed that he would never work on any soundtracks. Later, Glass composed the music for the 1985 film Mishima, which Alan Poole had acted in. Poole went on to produce Candyman, and when Bernard Rose threw out his dream composer to work on the film, Poole realized he had connections to Glass and set a meeting for Rose. The two talked about the movie, urban legends, characters, etc. Glass was quickly invested in the project and asked how Rose wanted to do it. Rose asked Glass not to write a score, but instead create a suite that he could cut up and use while editing the film. Before having seen any footage from the film, Glass wrote an early demo based on what he knew about the project. So instead of taking the traditional route of editing the film, then sending it to Glass to compose, they used and re-edited his demo music to help figure out the edit, then sent it back to Glass so he can make the final score, orchestrate a choir, and add in extra instruments. Because of this method, Glass only watched an early version of the film once. Rose feels that what happens too often is that the composers receive the picture-locked film only a few weeks before it's supposed to release, and because they have to work fast, the music is more likely to sound mediocre or the same. Another important aspect for Rose is that he didn't want the score to tell the audience when they're supposed to feel scared, because to him, it takes him out of the mood.
One of the things that I really always wanted to do was not have the score behave in the way that it normally does in a horror movie. Normally the score in a horror movie tells you when you're supposed to be scared, which to me is the same thing as telling me I'm not going to be scared. I'm a huge fan of Philip Glass's music, was before the film. I thought the score for Mishima was one of the best scores I'd ever heard, and I really loved Kind of Scotsy as well. I thought wow, if only we could get Philip Glass. And Alan Poole went, well, I know, I'll call him up. I went, I'll call him up.
After the film was released, supposedly Glass went to go watch the final movie at Times Square and was uncomfortable with the graphic nature of the film. Keep in mind that Glass was used to working on operas and artsy projects. On top of that, he didn't completely understand that he was working on a horror movie. It wasn't until he saw it with an audience where he felt how horrified everyone in the auditorium was. Glass hated the film until his manager showed him the amount of money he had made from the soundtrack, in which case he called Bernard Rose to ask to work for him again. As we hear Candyman say, I came for you in a spooky voiceover, we're introduced to Helen Lyles as she listens to a student recounting the Candyman urban legend. This acts as the film's setup. By the way, as far as the hero's journey, I'll be using Blake Snyder's method from Save the Cat. I did find they already posted a beat sheet, so I will be referencing that for this video. So major thanks to Don Roff for writing the blog and making it easier for me to pinpoint the different beats. I'll leave a link in the description so you can check out his blog for a deeper understanding of each beat. The boyfriend in this scene is played by Ted Raimi, Sam Raimi's younger brother. If you somehow don't know who Sam Raimi is, he's the guy who directed the Evil Dead trilogy, the Spider-Man trilogy, Drag Me to Hell, and the upcoming Doctor Strange film.
Candyman. She turned out the lights.
Clara is killed by a jump scare after saying Candyman for the fifth time. This effect was accomplished by using the classic Pepper's Ghost effect made popular by the Haunted Mansion ride at Disneyland. It's essentially done by having Tony Todd stand behind a black backdrop, then placing a mirror behind the actress here, and when they point a light towards Tony Todd, his reflection will appear transparent in the mirror. Also, in the final film, you have to say Candyman five times to summon him. However, if you refer back to the original shooting script, characters were required to say Candyman 13 times. Bernard Rose says he borrowed that number from the Bloody Mary legend that he heard of, in which you have to say Bloody Mary 13 times before she appeared. It wasn't until that first table read of the scene when he found out it's way too excessive. This is a great example that many times you can write an idea that feels like it works on paper, but the second someone says it out loud, you realize how flawed it is. Helen wraps up her interview and we meet her best friend Bernadette, played by Kasi Lemmons, who's also interviewing a student about the urban legend. The following scene introduces us to the ordinary world and Helen's husband, Trevor, who is a college professor giving a lecture on different folklore. After class, Helen meets up with him, but one of his students looks a little jealous about that kiss. No, I'm talking about her. Okay. This sets up our B plot for later. As Helen reviews the recorded conversation, a custodian named Henrietta overhears and calls in another cleaning woman named Kitty to tell Helen about the murders that occurred in Cabrini Green, where victims were butchered with a hook. This acts as the catalyst in the story. Quick side note, Henrietta is played by Barbara Austin, who was one of the founding members of the 1960s girl group, The Crystals. Intrigued by the murders Kitty told her about, Helen goes to the only place where he could research before the existence of Google. The library. On top of finding out the name of the victims, she also discovers her apartment building was designed the same way as Cabrini Green, especially with the push-through medicine cabinets that lead to a small room linking apartments together. Because the apartments are the same, she comes to the conclusion that the Candyman legend with him coming out of the mirror was likely a murderer who knew of the hole in the wall. This speculation in Helen sets up the debate in the story. Unfortunately, that speculation leads to her being confident enough to say Candyman five times, which leads to Candyman jumping on Helen's bed in the middle of the night. Nah, just kidding, that's good old Trevor. Act 2 starts with Helen and Bernadette visiting Cabrini Green to visit the apartment where one of the murders took place to see if they can find anything on the other side of the medicine cabinet. The exteriors of this scene were all filmed at the actual Cabrini Green location. During production, there were at least 5 active gangs around. Instead of pushing them away, the filmmakers decided to incorporate some of them in hopes to help avoid any problems. The gang members you see here were real gang members at Cabrini Green that producers paid off to be in the film. The only line that was scripted was this one.
Hands up, people! Fire more! Come out the back door! Police!
Everything else was improvised by the hired gang. In the commentary, Clive Barker credits this to be a big reason why the film was so scary.
The power of the movie, I think, is increased hugely by the fact that we were able to actually be there and shoot and show the way these places are constructed.
Cast and crew members had to follow very specific instructions of where to hang out and not to hang out, where to park and not to park, and what hours they should avoid. Clearly, everyone was nervous about filming there. In fact, at one point towards the end of a shooting day, someone shot at the production generator they had on set, according to Kasi Lemmons and Virginia Madsen. Producer Alan Poole says they shot a bullet at the camera truck. Regardless of where they shot, it was a clear signal to everyone that they needed to hurry up and leave the area. And yes, there were cops on set to protect the crew, which is likely the reason why only one bullet was fired. In an interview with Kasi Lemmons, she says that Virginia Madsen and her befriended one of the people hanging out in the building they were filming at, who would end up acting as a guide for them. So yeah, it's a big deal that they filmed here because of how well known this area was for its crime and hostile living conditions. To paraphrase what producer Alan Poole said, Bernard Rose went deep into exploring the urban setting and the life of the African American community who lived at Cabrini Green. He picked a setting that was already deeply scary for many Americans and exploited it for horror in a way that did not exploit the actual people who worked on the projects. Many wonder why Rose didn't recreate Cabrini Green as a set. Well, it was important to Bernard Rose that they filmed at the actual location because he wanted as many documentary details as possible. After taking some pictures and coming out Candyman's mouth, they meet Anne Marie McCoy, who was the neighbor of the victim. Helen meets baby Anthony, and we get this foreshadowing piece of dialogue.
Yeah, they're not gonna get him.
Oh yeah, they will, for sure. The next scene acts as fun and games by showing Helen, Trevor, Bernadette, and her significant other, played by Bernard Rose, having lunch with folklore expert Philip Purcell. At the mention of Candyman, he tries to belittle Helen by telling her that he's already written an essay about the legend. We find out Candyman was the son of a slave who became rich after inventing a machine that could produce a mass amount of shoes. In 1815, after being hired to paint the portrait of a rich white man's daughter, the two fell in love and the daughter got impregnated. After the white father found out, he hired goons to brutally lynch Candyman, resulting in his right hand being cut off, stripping him naked, and being covered with the honeycomb of angry bees who sting Candyman to death. According to Purcell, Candyman's death took place in the same location where Cabrini Green is built on. Helen is pulled into this story and is more invested than ever into finding out more about Candyman. She returns to meet with Anne Marie, but finds she isn't home. Instead, she meets a young boy named Jake who tells her about the story of a kid who was brutally castrated in a public men's urinal. The actor who played Jake, DeJuan Guy, competed against many other kid actors. It was thanks to director John Singleton who gave DeJuan his big break to eventually land Candyman. Singleton sat in acting as a student during one of DeJuan's acting classes. He noticed DeJuan and cast him in a small role in Boys in the Hood. Unfortunately, that scene was cut from the film, but it later helped him land an audition for Candyman. DeJuan had auditioned, and while walking out towards his ride, Virginia Madsen ran out the building and told DeJuan he had gotten the role. The two would go on to have a great working relationship. In a Monster Mania convention, Madsen tells the story of a time when DeJuan went to Madsen's trailer and asked her why he doesn't have his own. Trying to be supportive, Madsen told him that if he works hard enough, he'll get there one day. DeJuan asked if he could bring his people in, and Madsen agreed. After bringing in his family and agent, the trailer essentially became his. Guess he really took Madsen's advice to heart. Another interesting thing about this scene is that the entire story of a boy getting castrated in the restroom is also in the short story by Clive Barker. In fact, Barker's grandmother would scare him as a child by warning him not to use public toilets because of men who would cut the genitals off little boys. Man, talk about having a shy bladder. Regardless, that story became the initial inspiration to write The Forbidden. On top of that, there was an actual serial killer in the early 70s who went by the Candyman because he owned a candy factory and was known to hand out free candy to local children. But I wasn't able to find any record of Barker saying this was another inspiration, so it's safe to assume it's simply a coincidence. Jake takes her to the public urinal where the castration happened, and Helen investigates the inside of the restroom. This is one of the scenes that Bernard Rose uses to show how cutting away relieves the audience of any tension, which is why he made this into a one-er. That also ties into why he never shoots coverage or films with two cameras, his main reason being that the studio will want to tighten the edit, even if it means sacrificing any buildup. While Jake is waiting outside, he meets the so-called Candyman, who corners Helen inside the restroom along with the other thugs and beats her unconscious. We cut to a police lineup where Helen identifies the man who stole Candyman's identity. Helen and Jake find out that the man had been using the Candyman legend to scare residents of Cabrini Green to stay silent, but now Helen's testimony will help put him away. Later, we see Helen and Bernadette talking about the unsettling fact that the death of two black victims went unnoticed while her mere assault led to the quick capture capture of Candyman. Bernadette reveals that Helen's film was saved after she got jumped. While looking at the slides and walking to her car, Helen is called out by the real deal in a haunting voice.
Helen.
Yes?
Helen.
During a Candyman panel, Virginia Madsen confessed that people have actually called her out as Helen while she walked to her car in a parking garage. For obvious reasons, she didn't find it amusing in the slightest and is sometimes even escorted to her car. Also, this is the first time we get a good shot of Candyman and it's great. Tony Todd's stance here tells you everything you need to know. The Candyman outfit is inspired by something that man would wear to the opera during the 1800s. Leonard Pollack came up with the concept and the second Bernard Rose saw it, he knew that was it. It gave Candyman a sense of royalty, even though Barker has said he isn't a fan of the coat. Helen is immediately entranced by Candyman. He explains that because the real killer of Cabrini Green is in jail, residents aren't scared of Candyman hurting them and the belief of Candyman is what keeps him alive. If Helen dies, people will believe in him again, letting him live on. Helen passes out, probably because of Tony Todd's dreamy voice.
Be my victim.
Funny enough, Bernard Rose says that as much as he loves Tony Todd's performance, he likes the film more before Candyman is introduced because he loves the buildup of a villain and all the mystery that is set up for him. This is something even Siskel and Ebert mentioned in their review. That's why Rose doesn't think horror sequels work well because you pretty much know everything about the antagonist. After a villain is revealed, you have to find a way to let the story continue without the suspense of knowing who the monster is. After thinking about it, this is likely why the first Nightmare on Elm Street was so frightening and the sequels were more action comedy oriented. The scene when the teenagers are all describing their nightmares with Fred Krueger is probably the most chilling scene of the film for me. But let's get back to Candyman. Helen wakes up confused and covered in blood. She opens the door and realizes she's in Anne-Marie's apartment after finding the decapitated dog. She comes across Anne-Marie, who is screaming hysterically after finding out her baby is missing. When Helen approaches her with a meat cleaver, Anne-Marie attacks. In an act of self-defense, Helen stabs her with the meat cleaver and holds her down right as police burst in.
Bernard is kind of a... He was a very, very passionate individual, and so if he wanted more blood, it was so hard not to laugh because he would become sort of maniacal and he'd grab the spray can of blood and start laughing and more blood, and spraying the blood all over the place. It was really funny. He was so insane sometimes.
She's arrested and is subjected to a strip search that is incredibly uncomfortable to watch. This scene was important to Rose because no matter the gender, having to strip down like Helen did is a scary thing to go through. As you may be able to tell, this was a difficult scene to shoot for Virginia Madsen. She mentions in the commentary how worried she was prior to filming, but trusted Rose would make her feel safe, and thankfully, it sounds like he did. In order to get the best performance for Madsen, she needed to feel safe, so Rose suggested she have a best friend play the role of the police officer. Madsen asked her best friend, Rusty Schwimmer, to play the part. This resulted in them having to only do two takes for the scene.
I was pretty worried about the strip search scene, but I knew I wouldn't be too badly abused because I really trusted Bernard and I knew that I was safe. But no one could hug me because I was covered head to toe with sticky Hershey syrup. And I smelled from the sticky fake blood. It kind of smells like real blood because it's slightly sweet smelling because of the Hershey syrup. So I couldn't put a robe on because the robe would stick to me. So they sort of stuck towels in front and back and people walked holding them on either side of me and nobody could hold me. And I was really shaken up after that scene. Yeah, that was really hard.
In the commentary, Rose makes an interesting point that a movie shouldn't have nudity, it should have nakedness, because oftentimes movies will have nude scenes for the hell of it, but he wanted to have it to show how frightening it is to be in Helen's shoes. Helen has read her rights by an irate detective whom we met earlier, clearly indicating that everyone thinks she's responsible for what happened. She attempts to call Trevor, but it looks like someone didn't come home for bed. He picks Helen up the next day and takes her back home where their lawyers explain she might get out scot-free if the police find the baby. Helen asks Trevor about his whereabouts when she tried calling, and he explains he was at home sleeping. There's something off about that Trevor guy. The next day, Helen looks through the slide and discovers Candyman was standing behind her in one of the mirror selfies she took. This acts as the point in the story where the bad guys close in. Now suspicious, she goes and takes a look at her medicine cabinet. Prior to shooting the scene, Bernard Rose wanted Tony Todd to jump out and scare Virginia Madsen, even though they were just getting a reaction shot. It took a lot of convincing, but Tony Todd finally agreed. So that's a legitimate jump for Madsen. Helen attempts to run away while Candyman keeps reappearing. Once again, she's entranced by him as he tells her to be his victim so she can become immortal with him. At the same time, Bernadette shows up to Helen's apartment, which proves to be extremely unfortunate timing for her. Helen passes out again and wakes up to find herself in cuffs. She runs towards Trevor and sees Bernadette's mutilated body, signifying all hope is lost. Helen is admitted into a mental institution where she's strapped down. She sees Candyman float above her as he tells her she has nowhere to go but with him. Helen yells at Candyman, then is knocked out by the medics. This scene acts as a dark night of the soul. She wakes up and is taken to Dr. Burke, where she finds out she had been there for an entire month. Helen is then shown the security footage where she yells at an empty ceiling. Trying to save herself, she calls out Candyman's name in the mirror 5 times, resulting in Candyman fatally booty punching Dr. Burke. Candyman sets Helen free and flies out the window in the scary looking stunt. You can tell there was no CGI because if this was today, they could easily CGI out the wires holding Candyman, especially since it was actually a dangerous shot to do, according to Rose. Also, all these hospital scenes were filmed at the Ambassador Hotel, the same building where Robert Kennedy was fatally shot in 1968. Helen escapes and runs back home to Trevor. When she arrives, she finds her apartment painted in a disgusting pink color. Helen is shocked when she finds Trevor's student from earlier, Stacy, painting the walls. This is the most heartbreaking scene of the film for me because at this point, we see how much Helen is suffering. Everyone has gone against her and thinks she's crazy, so when we found out that the last person she relied on was cheating on her, it's legitimately hard to watch. I think Bernard Rose effectively used silence here to convey so many emotions. Helen throws some paint on the wall, then leaves the apartment. In the next shot, we see her looking down at the Chicago River. In the original shooting script, the action describes her making the decision to die, but stopping herself when Candyman reveals he has the child. Acting as the beginning of Act 3 and the point in the story where the team is gathered, Helen returns to Cabrini Green to confront Candyman. She finds him asleep and takes the opportunity to kill him with a dangling hook, executing her plan. Unfortunately for her, he's immune to stabbings and instead asks her to surrender to him. Helen is once again entranced by Candyman, and the two have a romantic spin that leads to Candyman carrying Helen like Frankenstein's monster. Probably one of the most bizarre facts I learned about this film is that for all of these shots of Helen entranced by the Candyman, Virginia Madsen was legitimately hypnotized. Bernard Rose hates it when actors scream and cry, so he opted to have anyone who sees Candyman find themselves in a trance, similar to how Dracula's victims feel. Oh, and he was also inspired by Werner Herzog.
It's quite a spooky thing, putting someone in a trance, because, you know, they're in a trance. They obey. Good way to have your actress, though. And I thought, if Werner Herzog's done it, I'm gonna try it.
Madsen was once told by a psychic never to get hypnotized because all of her dark thoughts would open. After filming this movie, she said the psychic was right. During pre-production, Rose and Madsen went to a hypnotist, and even though she was expecting no results, she found herself at one point with her arm up mid-conversation with no conscious memory of when she did that. At the end of the session, the hypnotist gave Rose a trigger word to use on set to get Madsen back into that state. Neither Rose or Madsen remember using the word, so don't bother looking it up. Anyways, when she gets hypnotized for the film, it put her in a really intense state of relaxation. Her eyes would get really glassy and her pupils would dilate. You could normally tell when they did it by the lighting, which was inspired by the shot of Julia Christie's character in Dr. Zhivago. When they started, it took Rose about 10 to 15 minutes to get Madsen into that hypnotic state. They had to leave the set and be escorted back to a silent crew. Towards the end, Rose was able to hypnotize Madsen without having to take her to another room and would instead do it in a corner. According to Madsen, when going into that hypnotic state, she would start to not be able to hear anything else other than the sound of Bernard Rose's voice. Alan Poole says it was taxating on the crew because they would get the scene ready and have the lights and camera up, then Bernard Rose would come in on set. At this point, the crew had to stay completely still and quiet down. Rose would then softly speak to Madsen and hypnotize her for about 20 minutes. He would then whisper "roll camera." There was no slate or any yelling, it would just turn into a very quiet shoot. Madsen says one of the most challenging aspects of filming was not being touched because she would either be covered in blood, hypnotized, or have burned makeup. She felt very separated from the crew, and feels Rose loved that because that's how Helen was feeling, isolated and alone. By the end of filming, Madsen says getting hypnotized wasn't a good place to be because she would forget entire shooting days, and Rose knew that, so they had to stop with that method. According to Alan Poole, they also hypnotized Kasi Lemmons when she came in contact with Candyman.
We took about a week off because it just got bad. You know, we all had to walk away for the holidays. We finished on Christmas Eve, and we came back right after New Year's.
Referring back to the movie, Helen reveals Candyman's bee-filled torso, so he takes the opportunity to make his move and decides to kiss Helen with a mouthful of bees, resulting in her passing out. Again. The shot of bees coming out of Tony Todd's mouth was 100% real. I originally thought maybe they made a prosthetic head of some sorts, but no, that's actually Todd in the shot. Mark Coulier made a denture that would go inside Todd's mouth, with latex sheets that would grip to the sides of his mouth to protect him from bees. Unfortunately, while delivering a line, Tony Todd said one of the bees got behind the denture and was crawling to the end of his mouth. Also, for the chest reveal, they used foam latex and a plastic for the ribs. The chest piece had lungs that could deflate and inflate to make it look like he was breathing. The trick to making the effect look real is to avoid having it look like it was sticking out too far. Thankfully, they had a lot of experience with Frank and Hellraiser. The entire chest area was covered with sweet syrup to attract the bees. Unfortunately, they would sting if they got stuck under the arm or collar. The good thing is, Tony Todd would receive a bonus every time he got stung. To get the bees on Candyman, Norman Gary would paint Tony Todd with queen bee pheromone, which would make bees think Tony Todd was the queen bee. These shots took days to film because of how complicated it was. According to Rose, everyone got stung and it got to a point where crew members wouldn't show up to work because they were so freaked out at how many bees there were. I guess it seems like they were hiving a problem. Helen wakes up and finds herself alone. As she walks through the lair, she finds a piece of graffiti that shows Candyman's lost love, signifying the Hightower surprise. Production designer Jane Ann Stewart went to Cabrini Green with the other filmmakers during pre-production to get a feel of the scenes they would film there. An aspect she took back to her work was the feeling of having to go through holes and always discovering new rooms. In real life, the Cabrini Green walls were so fragile you could actually punch a hole in the wall, steal everything, then leave. This is what inspired her sets for Candyman. She wanted Helen to almost feel like she was in a maze. For all the graffiti in Candyman's lair, Stewart worked with artist Kelly Deco to make up all the art on the walls. After Deco finished her work, she used glycerin and paint to wear down the paintings as much as possible to give the scene more texture. When Helen walks outside, she hears the cries of the baby inside a large pile of garbage. As she enters to save baby Anthony, Jake wakes up and assumes Candyman has arrived. Now I'm not sure, but I'm going out on a limb and saying that because Jake helped Helen earlier, he assumed the Candyman would come after him and that's why he was sleeping in that pile of wood, to lure Candyman into a trap. I don't think this was ever confirmed, so that's my theory. Also, Rose originally wanted to keep the location of the baby a mystery and confirmed that he was alive at this point in the story when Helen heard him inside the giant piles of wood. But the studio didn't want to cause too much confusion, so they asked Rose to add some flashing shots of the baby to show he was safe. The rest of the residents from Cabrini Green quickly used gasoline and torches to light up the bonfire, trapping Helen and the baby inside. Again, another similarity to the original Frankenstein. For the wide shots with the Chicago skyline, the production built an actual bonfire using truckloads of trash. Obviously, no one was inside this fire. For all the shots that required any actors, they filmed those in the stage and built out sections that cast members could go through. As the fire lights up, Helen digs deep down to save the baby and attempt to escape, but is stopped when Candyman holds her back from leaving, breaking his promise to let the baby live if Helen stays with him. Helen makes eye contact with Anne-Marie, who stares inside the fire. She gains the strength to stab Candyman with a burning piece of wood and escape. This acts as Helen executing the new plan, especially since her last stabbing didn't go so well. Candyman calls out for Helen as she escapes. When the residents realize Helen was inside, they quickly grab the baby and put Helen out. Meanwhile, Candyman lets out a massive roar, causing his chest to explode with bees. Knowing she made it out with the baby, Helen dies from her fire injuries. Virginia Madsen had to sit in for 5.5 hours to get all the prosthetics and burn the makeup done. She's credited this role to be the most elaborate makeup work she's gone through. Speaking of makeup, in the commentary, Rose talks about how he doesn't go into the makeup department because he's aware that actors will often complain about stuff, and if he goes in, he might worsen things or slow things down. He wants that area to be a safe place for actors to get their frustrations out, then come back to set ready to work. We cut to Helen's funeral where we see Trevor, Stacy, Purcell, and Richie, another Bernard Rose cameo, looking down at Helen's casket being lowered. Suddenly, they see a long line of residents from Cabrini Green show up and pay their respects to Helen. Anne-Marie, baby Anthony, and Jake stand at the front. Jake throws Candyman's hook inside Helen's grave, signifying Candyman's death. In the commentary, producer Alan Poole says this funeral scene was one of the most difficult scenes to film because they needed many extras, more than they could simply pay for. The way they overcame this was by promoting an extras call through the radio, flyers, and overall community. Then those extras would all be in a raffle that would give them something like a TV, car, or other such big prize to make it worth their time. On that particular day, they were assured they would have 500 people, but they only got a third of that. Rose's solution was to reuse extras and move them to the back of the line to give the impression that there were more people. Nowadays, this isn't an issue for bigger budget films since they can shoot that small group of extras on a blue screen, then duplicate them in post. By the way, in an interview with the Juan guy, he said that his aunt is right behind him during the scene, so I'm going to go out on a limb and assume this is her. After the funeral, we cut to the final scene of the film where Trevor is sitting alone in the bathroom, grieving over Helen's death. We see Stacy being all angry as Trevor remembers Helen's sweet gestures. Thankfully, Trevor gets his comeuppance when he accidentally says Helen's name 5 times in the mirror. Helen has now become the urban legend she was initially researching in the beginning of the film. When Stacy walks in, she screams after finding Trevor's dead body in the bathtub. The credits roll as the camera zooms into a painting of Helen, which the script describes her as rising from the bonfire like a phoenix. This last shot leaves us in a new world where Helen's own legend has only just begun. The original ending didn't include the scene with Trevor in the bathroom summoning Helen. That was part of the reshoots which required crew to rebuild and repaint the apartment set. The first ending had the camera go through Candyman's lair, similar to this shot in the credits, but instead of zooming in on the painting of Helen, it would go inside a crack on the wall, revealing Helen inside a giant beehive with thousands of bees all over her head. Then Helen wakes up and the film cuts to black. This was actually filmed but left on the cutting room floor. Virginia Madsen said she was proud of herself for filming the scene because of how hard it was. Since there were warm lights, Madsen started to sweat so the glue from her prosthetics started to wear down and bees would go down her costume. After wrapping up, it took the bee wrangler 45 minutes to vacuum all the bees. You can imagine how upsetting it must have been for Madsen when she found out they did all that work only to have to reshoot the ending. According to Rose, if they kept the original ending, the sequel he initially wrote would have started with Trevor in the bathroom being visited by Helen. But with all that, now it's time we take a look at the film's story wheel to see if there are any setups and payoffs that stick out. For the first one, this is when someone says a name in the mirror 5 times. We first see it in the flashback where Clara says Candyman and is killed.
Candyman. She turned out the lights.
Then Helen says it in the bathroom mirror to prove she doesn't believe in it and is later confronted by Candyman.
Candyman.
Later in the film, Helen says it while having her meeting with Dr. Burke,
Candyman,
which leads to the doctor's death. Finally, the film ends with Trevor saying Helen's name 5 times, resulting in her coming back and killing Trevor as a sign that she's now cursed to take Candyman's place. This next one is slightly different from the first one. This is all the times someone got hurt in a restroom. First, we see Clara getting killed. Then we hear the story of the young boy who was castrated in the public urinal. Shortly after, Helen is beat up in the restroom after investigating, and finally, Trevor is found dead in the bathtub after saying Helen's name 5 times. Up next is the first and last time Cabrini-Green is visited. Helen and Bernadette visit the projects in the beginning of the second act to investigate Candyman's rumor. In the beginning of the third act, Helen returns to confront Candyman in his lair. This next one is simply a visual representation of all the times we see a shot of swarming bees. The first time is after the credits. We see the swarming bees and hear Candyman's voice. The next time we see a similar shot is immediately after Candyman puts Helen in a trance and has her pass out. Later, after Helen finds Bernadette's mutilated body, the film refers back to a similar shot while Candyman's voice can be heard alongside shots of baby Anthony. Finally, we see the shot of swarming bees after Candyman is killed in the bonfire. This is all the times Anne Marie is in the film. We first see her peek out of her apartment while the two women are investigating. After having investigated what would later be known as Candyman's lair, Anne Marie introduces herself and baby Anthony. When Helen returns to talk to Anne Marie, she doesn't find her home and is instead scared by her Rottweiler. At the exact midpoint for the film, Helen wakes up in Anne Marie's home to find a decapitated Rottweiler and Anne Marie hysterically screaming after finding out someone stole her baby. Finally, Helen sees Anne Marie as she's trying to gain the strength to get the baby out of the bonfire. This next one is one of my favorites. This is all the time we get this Dr. Zhivago type shot of Helen's eyes. We first get a close-up when the film begins, right after Candyman's voiceover. We later see it while Helen is investigating inside Cabrini-Green for the first time. Whenever Purcell is telling Candyman's origin story, we get this similar shot of Helen with her glossy eyes. When Helen meets Candyman, she's immediately put in a trance. Later, while she's alone in her apartment, Candyman shows up and Helen enters that hypnotized state again. Lastly, we see her in this state right after she tries to kill Candyman in his sleep. All these events give us a nice little star. Let's get to a simple one. This is when Helen mentions the bonfire.
Somebody building a bonfire?
Yeah, for the party.
And this is when she finds herself inside it. A big part of this movie is going behind mirrors. We find out about this while Helen is researching at the library. In the next scene, Helen shows Bernadette how the back of her mirror cabinet can pop off. She's later crawling through the same type of holes at Cabrini-Green while researching Candyman. Finally, this all pays off in this great scare when Helen opens the bathroom mirror. Next up are all the times the camera emphasizes graffiti on the wall. First is when we see Sweets to the Sweet in Cabrini-Green. A few minutes later, we see Helen coming out of Candyman's graffitied mouth. Then we see Sweets to the Sweet is written on the public restroom wall with feces. At the beginning of the third act, Helen returns to Cabrini-Green and finds Candyman's origin story told through graffiti on the wall. Helen later wakes up after passing out from the bee's kiss and finds these words written on the wall. Finally, the last important piece of graffiti is the last shot of the movie when Helen is shown emerging from the bonfire. Helen does a lot of sleeping in this movie, so let's count up all the times she's passed out. First is when she's jumped in the restroom and knocked unconscious. Second is when she's entranced by Candyman and passes out. Third is after finding out Bernadette was killed. Fourth time is when she's yelling at Candyman but the doctor thinks she's having an episode so they give her a shot to go to sleep. And finally, she passes out after getting kissed with a mouthful of bees. Oh, and I guess you could also count when she dies. For the last setup and payoff, this follows the bee plot with Trevor. We first meet Trevor while he's giving a lecture in a university. Helen asks why one of his students couldn't make eye contact with her, and he jokes she probably has a crush on him. After waking up in the middle of the night, Trevor returns home very late and scares Helen by jumping on the bed. Later, Helen surprises Trevor when he comes home from work with a romantic dinner. After Helen is arrested, she calls home but Trevor doesn't pick up, even though it's 3 a.m. and he should be there. When Helen questions where he was, Trevor says he was at home asleep and simply didn't hear the phone. At her lowest point in the story, Helen runs home to Trevor and finds out he was cheating with the student from earlier.
What's the matter, Trevor? Scared of something?
We later see Trevor and Stacy at Helen's funeral, and in the last scene of the movie, Trevor mourns Helen as he remembers her sweet gestures. He accidentally says her name 5 times in the mirror, resulting in her showing up and killing him.
What's the matter, Trevor? Scared of something?
Overall, there was a lot to find in this film, and I'm positive there's more that I missed, so please let me know if you find anything else worth noting. After having watched this film at least 6 times, then reading the short story by Clive Barker, there were a few similarities and differences, so I'm going to go through these as quickly as I can. Keep in mind, I'm just breezing through these because this video is already long as hell, so let's go. As far as character names, they all remain the same. There are also scenes that parallel the film, like the dinner scene where Helen learns the origin of Candyman. The book also has a part where Helen finds chocolates and caramels with razor blades nearby. Helen finds a large man with waxy yellow skin, pale blue lips, and wild eyes. The large man makes Helen drowsy, and he even says the same words as Tony Todd's depiction of Candyman. 2 pages later, she discovers his bee-filled torso. Surprisingly, Candyman's role is a lot shorter than I expected in the book. He doesn't show up until the last 6 pages. There's also no mention of having to say his name in the mirror. Instead, he was summoned by doubting his existence. In the film, Jake tells Helen about the story where a young boy was castrated in the public restroom. In the book, it was originally a 20-year-old mentally challenged boy who was castrated. Both versions describe him to be better off dead. Another major difference was the ending. In the book, Anne-Marie still plays a major part in the story, but makes a lot of bad decisions. For example, at one point, Helen arrives at Anne-Marie's apartment to find it filled with cops. She discovers that Anne-Marie had cut open her child's throat as a sacrifice to Candyman and is detained. At the end of the story, Helen finds the body of the baby inside the bonfire and attempts to retrieve it, but Candyman jumps out and grabs her. Helen peeps out through the flames and sees Trevor looking for her in the crowd. The final sentences read, "Poor dupe," she thought, following his antics. She willed him to look past the flames in hopes that he might see her burning. Not so that he could save her from death, she was long past hope of that, but because she pitied him in his bewilderment and wanted to give him, though he would have not thanked her for it, something to be haunted by. That, and a story to tell. A bone-chilling ending in my opinion. Another aspect the film added in was having Trevor cheat on Helen. In the book, it's made obvious that the two aren't a happy couple. It's to the point where Helen says she's happy when he's gone and can be alone. Trevor's gesture at the end where he shows up to bonfire night to look for Helen was a sign that he does care for her even a little bit. That's at least how I interpret it. But yes, finally, the biggest change between the short story and the film is the location. The short story takes place in the slums of Liverpool with underlying themes of class, while the film takes place in Chicago with underlying themes of race. A choice Rose felt would faithfully stay in tune with Barker's original story while making it fit for American audiences. That's why the original short story ends on Guy Fawkes Night, while the film simply has the bonfire there, almost as a trap for Candyman.
So Candyman had an influence on me, I would say, but at the same time, there's this sort of prickly, conversation about what happens when white filmmakers, and in this case it was based on a short story by Clive Barker that was not all about race. So in transferring it to a US setting, of course that third rail of race seems like a really natural place to open.
Well, race is to America as class is to England in many ways.
If you're a fan of Candyman, I recommend reading the short story. It's well written and just as disturbing as the film. This is an interesting example where the short story was improved upon in the film. It helps that Rose decided not to make it a literal adaptation and instead make a film that explored race issues in America. So while it was different, at its core, it stayed true to the emotional and psychological impact that Clive Barker intended to hit. While writing the screenplay, Rose knew he wanted to discuss issues of race in the film. He worked closely with Kasi Lemmons to get feedback on any racial politics. Like I mentioned earlier, Rose even had meetings with the NAACP, but after they read the script, they realized there was nothing wrong with having a black man play a horror villain.
I remember, wondering, well, why did we have to be the villain? Why do we have to be the monster? Well, the fact is that there is actually one sense in which that is social progress. You know, assuming that there are other representations at the same time at your local movie theater.
Right.
And in 1992, you had Sidney Poitier in his last really good movie, Sneakers, and you had Wesley Snipes in White Men Can't Jump. So if you have a full representation, now, okay, we can be the monster, because we can also be the hero. You know, if you can't be the hero, then it's not fair to ask you to be the monster or play the fool.
As they neared the release of the film on October 16th, 1992, tensions started building from the Rodney King trials that were happening at the time. In fact, Rose was scheduled to have a final test screening of the film, but it was cancelled due to the riots occurring in that same week. Everyone involved with the project was nervous about how people would react to the film. On top of that, the filmmakers were aware that for some reason, there were actually some people uncomfortable seeing an interracial couple on screen.
Nobody thought it was a good idea. Oh, why are you casting? Can't cast an African guy, is that? No. Which to me, it was like saying you couldn't have an African man play Dracula.
Just the base fact of this being interracial, that made some people very uncomfortable. I love that.
After its release, some of the producers even rented out a limo and rode around theater to see how people were reacting to the film. The Juan guy, who played Jake, was not a fan of horror movies but wanted to see himself on the big screen, so he went to the showing and saw his name in the credits, then one of the producers escorted him out and brought him back only to watch the scenes he was in. He later went during the theatrical release but kept his eyes closed for most of the runtime. But that didn't stop him from having recurring nightmares that led to him having to sleep with his aunt. The film nearly got an NC-17 rating from the MPAA, so Rose had to cut down any scenes with spraying blood to get the R rating. Thankfully, the NC-17 version can be found on the Scream Factory Blu-ray as the uncut version. For those who are wondering, the differences between the uncut and theatrical versions are very minimal. The uncut film simply shows a few more seconds of gore rather than cutting away to a reaction shot. Thankfully, this isn't a Blade Runner situation, so regardless of what version you watch, there won't be any noticeable changes. I watched both cuts back to back and barely noticed. The film was released in October 1992 and was well received critically. In a mostly positive review given by Roger Ebert, he touches on an aspect Rose mentioned where it's important to have any supernatural story be as realistic as possible so that the supernatural elements are that much freakier, and avoid explaining as much as you possibly can to keep that mystery alive.
If you're gonna frighten somebody, everything that's around the thing that's frightening has to be real. And it has to be convincing and has to be really well thought out.
Years after its initial release, Candyman is considered by many as a modern horror classic with its gothic sceneries, haunting score, and one of the most popular black horror villains to be portrayed on the silver screen. Bernard Rose intentionally showed this character in the daylight to warn the audience that he's not a monster that can hide in the dark. He's a monster born out of racism and haunts those who don't believe his tragic story. Some audiences found this story to be racist for having a black boogeyman be vengeful and obsessed with a white woman while using Cabrini Green as the main location for the film. Others found this film to be progressive by having a lead villain played by a black man.
It was very empowering to me to feel like we could, like black people can do anything. We're not in this box. We can be the Freddy of a movie.
By definition, this is a horror film in every sense. It's deeply disturbing with its underlying themes of race and horrific imagery. At the end, we see Helen scream for help as the angry crowd surrounds the fire, not being able to hear her. This somewhat mirrors Candyman's death, where it's likely he cried for help but no one dared save him. There are thousands of essays that take a deeper look into the film and argue both sides, so I'm simply scratching the surface. If you'd like to get a deeper perspective into the themes of the film and learn more about the history of black horror, I highly recommend checking out the Shudder documentary, Horror Noir. It's extremely well made and incredibly insightful. It's an absolute must watch for any horror fan. There were two Candyman sequels released in the 90s, but they didn't do nearly as well as the original. Bernard Rose has even said that he's never bothered watching the other films. He did write a draft for the studio that was inspired by another Clive Barker story, Midnight Meat Train. It would have explored Helen acting as the new villain alongside Candyman. However, the studio rejected the idea, so Barker left the franchise. A new Candyman film was supposed to come out in 2020, but because of the pandemic, it was delayed. With Jordan Peele acting as a co-screenwriter and Nia DaCosta directing, I'm feeling very optimistic. Based off the trailer, it looks like it'll be more of a sequel following the grown-up baby Anthony. I also say this because Vanessa Williams returns as Anne Marie, which let me just say that she legitimately hasn't aged a day. But until the new film comes out, if you want something Candyman related, I recommend watching Clive Barker's original short film that was based on the same ideas for his short story. It's a very trippy, artsy student film that only Clive Barker could make. If that's not your thing, I recommend checking out the film's commentary with Bernard Rose and Tony Todd. There's some hilarious banter between the two that I couldn't resist adding to this video.
I remember seeing it. I've shot there a couple times, but I think I don't understand why I was on set every day.
Yeah.
Why was I on fucking set? You guys thought I was going to run away?
I have no idea.
It doesn't make any sense. I mean, like 10 minutes of the film. I could have fucking gone on vacation.
But weren't you getting paid?
Yeah, I was getting paid, but still. You're no longer looking at me. You're looking past me like I'm not even here.
No, I'm here.
We're here, folks. But I just want you to know that I've given this man my undivided attention for 90 minutes on a Saturday that is filled with sports possibilities, all right? And I'm going home, and I'm going to crash and get on my couch and maybe play God of War.
And that wraps up Candyman. Thanks for sticking around. There is a lot more information than I expected. Also, quick side note, is it just me, or does Helen look a lot like Scully from the X-Files? Regardless, as a final reward for those of you who watch this hour-long video, I'm gonna show you what actually happens if you say Candyman's name 5 times in a mirror. And for those of you who just skipped to the end, well, you're a punk.
Candyman. 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 Candyman.
Hey, Renee.
Oh, fuck.
Come with me and be immortal.
I'm a bit busy right now, but since you're here, how about sharing a favorite video store memory?
Well, you know, I'm an early child of Blockbuster and Hollywood Video, and I can remember paying top dollar. What was it, $5 per video, getting 3 at a time, the next day, return. Always showing up late, finally learning how to accept the thing on rewind.
Well, any favorite horror film?
Toss up Bride of Frankenstein for its serious overtones, but for totality, Abbott and Costello meet Frankenstein.
Great choices. There's a lot of really good Frankenstein movies out there. Personally, my favorite one is Curse of Frankenstein. But anyways, thank you, Mr. Man, for coming out, and thank you for watching. Until next time, be kind to others and keep watching movies.
Renee, be my victim.
I said no!